Before we go any farther in our discussion of nuclear safeguards, we should review some basic terminology that will be used in this module. The IAEA defines nuclear material as any source or special fissionable material. This covers all fissionable material. So what does that mean? Well, source material generally refers to any material containing either thorium or uranium that is not enriched in uranium-235 above what is found in nature. So this would include natural uranium, depleted uranium, and thorium, and includes these in any physical or chemical form. It can also be a combination of these materials. It does not apply to ores or ore residue, but does apply to ore concentrates. Special fissionable material is plutonium-239, uranium-233, uranium enriched in the isotopes 235 or 233, and any material containing one or more of these. The term special fissionable material does not include source material. Fissionable material is any isotope or mixture of isotopes that is capable of nuclear fission. Material type. Nuclear material type is the classification of nuclear material according to the element it contains and, in the case of uranium, the degree of enrichment. When we talk about nuclear material in this module, we're referring to uranium, plutonium, and thorium in any form. As such, the nuclear material types are plutonium, thorium, and the different forms of uranium, which are uranium-233, highly enriched uranium, or HEU, depleted uranium, natural uranium, and low enriched uranium, or LEU. Material category. The material category is a way of categorizing nuclear material according to its irradiation status and its suitability for conversion into components of nuclear explosive devices. The three material categories are unirradiated direct use material, irradiated direct use material, and indirect use material. Direct use material refers to nuclear material that can be used for the manufacture of a nuclear explosive device without transmutation or further enrichment. This would be plutonium that contains less than 80% plutonium-238, highly enriched uranium, and uranium-233. This also includes chemical compounds, mixtures of direct use materials such as mixed oxide fuels, and the plutonium in spent reactor fuel. All of these are also considered direct use materials. For the material category, we also distinguish between irradiated and unirradiated direct use materials. The radiation level is considered to influence the strategic value of the material, since material with a higher level of radiation is more dangerous to handle and therefore more difficult to divert and convert into a weapon. Unirradiated direct use material is direct use material that does not contain substantial amounts of fission products. This material could be a higher threat for diversion and conversion into a nuclear weapon because of its relatively low radiation level. One example of an irradiated direct use material would be the plutonium in spent reactor fuel. The high levels of radiation due to the fission products in the spent fuel make it less desirable as a target for diversion, since it's dangerous to handle and to transport. Indirect use material is any nuclear material other than the direct use material. So, this would be anything that cannot be used to manufacture a nuclear device as is. These materials would require either transmutation or further enrichment to obtain direct use materials. Examples of indirect use materials include depleted, natural, and low-enriched uranium. In safeguards, you will often hear the term significant quantity. A significant quantity, or SQ, is the approximate amount of nuclear material for which the possibility of manufacturing a nuclear explosive device cannot be excluded. In other words, a significant quantity is the minimum approximate amount of material someone would need to create a nuclear weapon. The significant quantity is different depending on the material category of the nuclear material, and it does account for unavoidable losses due to the conversion and manufacturing process. This is the reason why the significant quantity would be much larger for indirect use materials than for direct use materials. A much larger quantity of indirect use material, say, low-enriched uranium, would be necessary to create enough highly enriched uranium for a weapon through the enrichment process. The number of significant quantities present in a nuclear facility is one of the criteria used by the IAEA in establishing how frequently they should inspect a given facility. Material balance area. A material balance area, or MBA, is an area in or outside of a facility such that the quantity of nuclear material in each transfer into or out of each MBA can be determined. Facilities are divided into MBAs according to where it is easiest to measure material going in and going out. Material balance period. A material balance period, or MBP, is the period between two consecutive physical inventory takings. A physical inventory is the sum of all the measured quantities of nuclear material physically present within an MBA in a given MBP. The physical inventory is taken by the facility operator and reported to IAEA according to an inventory schedule established by the IAEA. The inventory schedule will be largely based on the material category of materials contained within the MBA. A strategic point is a location that is selected during examination of design information, where under normal conditions and when combined with the information from all strategic points taken together, the information necessary and sufficient for the implementation of safeguards measures is obtained and verified. A strategic point may include any location where key measurements related to material balance accountancy are made and where containment and surveillance measures are executed. A key measurement point, or KMP, is a location where nuclear material appears in such a form that it can be measured to determine material flow or inventory. KMPs include, but are not limited to, all of the inputs and outputs and storages in the MBAs. Nuclear materials are also classified by their material form, whether they could be considered as items or as bulk. Item form refers to individually identifiable units that are kept intact during their stay in an MBA. These are generally things that you can easily count, like fuel assemblies, bundles, pins, plates, etc. Bulk form refers to material in loose form, such as liquid, gas, or powder, or in a large number of small units like pellets or pebbles that are not each individually identified for nuclear material accountancy purposes. Bulk form material measurements can result in material unaccounted for, or MUF. This MUF is partially due to uncertainties in bulk measurements, things like weight, enrichment, flow rate, and so forth, when compared to counting in the case of item-type nuclear materials, such as fuel bundles. For instance, when we have three fuel bundles going into an MBA, we should be able to count those same three fuel bundles coming back out. A non-zero MUF for item accountancy would indicate a problem. There are additional verifications that are done on items in item accounting. Since our items are discrete, we should also be able to identify them with a serial number or some other form of identification. If the fuel bundles in our example are misidentified, or the integrity of the item is compromised, say, by fuel pins having been removed from the fuel bundles, then this would trigger a further investigation. Depending upon the type of items and the type of facility, items will also be checked for material content or radiation signatures to verify that they are consistent with what is expected based on the accounting records. In the case of bulk materials, precise measurement of materials going into and out of the MBA is more difficult. I may measure a certain quantity of powder or liquid going into an MBA, but bulk measurements always have some degree of uncertainty due to the measurement equipment or the measurement procedure, or from any processing that may occur within the MBA, or from holdup of nuclear materials in the pipes or tanks within the MBA where the material is processed. Facilities, as well as MBAs, can also be categorized by the types of materials they handle. An item facility, or an item MBA, is a place where all nuclear material is kept in item form, and the integrity of the item remains unaltered during its stay in that area or facility. This would include most reactors and the storage installations for reactor fuel. Bulk handling facilities, or bulk handling MBAs, are facilities or MBAs where nuclear material is held, processed, or used in bulk form, such as conversion plants, enrichment, fuel fabrication, and spent fuel reprocessing and storage facilities for bulk material. Conversion time. Conversion time refers to the time required to convert different forms of nuclear material to the metallic components of a nuclear explosive device. It does not include the time required to transport diverted material to the conversion facility, or to assemble the device. Diversion activity is assumed to be part of a planned sequence of actions chosen to give a high probability of success in manufacturing one or more nuclear explosive devices with minimal risk of discovery until at least one such device is manufactured. Detection time. Detection time is the maximum amount of time that may elapse between the diversion of a given amount of nuclear material and the detection of that diversion by IAEA safeguards activities. Detection time is one factor used to establish the timeliness component of the IAEA inspection goal. The timeliness detection goal refers to the target detection times applicable to specific nuclear material categories. Timeliness detection goals are used for establishing the frequency of inspections and safeguards activities to verify that no abrupt diversion has occurred. Detection goals are as follows: 1 month for unirradiated direct use material, 3 months for irradiated direct use material, and 1 year for indirect use material. Diversion rate. The diversion rate is the amount of nuclear material that could be diverted in a given unit of time. This could be a lot of material being diverted at once, or small amounts being removed little by little over a long time. An abrupt diversion occurs when a significant quantity or more of nuclear material is diverted within a period that's less than the MBP. Protracted diversion is the diversion of one significant quantity or more that occurs gradually over an MBP. The detection probability is the probability that safeguards activities will lead to detection if diversion of a given amount of nuclear material has occurred. We generally consider anything less than 20% to be an unacceptably low detection probability, in which case additional measures like containment and surveillance may be added to the KMP, and it may become a strategic point. The false alarm probability is the probability that statistical analysis of nuclear material accountancy verification data would indicate that an amount of nuclear material is missing, when in fact no diversion has occurred. The false alarm probability is generally set to 5% or less to minimize the number of discrepancies or false anomalies to be investigated. These are just some of the terms that you will need to be familiar with before we proceed with our discussion of nuclear safeguards, their history, and how they are applied at nuclear facilities.